Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Calvary Church Online. I'm Pastor John Mark, and I want to welcome you and thank you for joining us. If this is your first time joining us, we are so glad that you're here, and we would love to connect with you. We encourage you to text NEW to the number on the screen or reach out in the text box so one of our hosts can connect with you right away. Today, we kick off the season of Advent. We will be singing songs of praise, reading scripture, and Pastor Kathleen will be bringing us our teaching today as we start our new series called He Shall Be Called. And today, specifically, diving into Wonderful Counselor. Now let's focus our minds and souls as we spend some time in musical worship.
Good news of great joy for everyone and everywhere. This will be a sign of you. A baby born in Bethlehem. Well, come and worship. Do not be afraid. A company of angels, glory in the highest. When on earth the peace among those of whom His favor rests. Come and worship, do not be afraid. My soul, magnifies the Lord. My soul, magnifies the Lord. He has done great things for me. Unto us a child is born, well, unto us a son is given. Let every heart prepare his throne, let every nation under him. Well, come and worship, do not be afraid.
Today we're reading from Isaiah 9. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Oh, come, oh, come.
Thank you so much, Pastor Robbie, for that time of worship. I'd ask that you join me in prayer. Dear God, we just thank you so much that we can celebrate you in this season. As we celebrate Christmas, as we see the lights wherever we go, as we think of all the things that are about to come up, may we not forget you in the midst of it. May we be reminded of your love for us, of what you did for us, that you came to earth so that we could have everlasting life with you. God, we're thankful for who you are, and God, for everything going on in this world right now. God, I just pray peace over that for every person listening, for whatever situation they're facing. God, I pray that you would give them peace, that they'd sense your presence today wherever they listen to this from. God, we love you so much. Thank you so much for who you are, what you've done in our lives, and what you're going to do. Amen. These are your announcements for this week. Next Sunday is our church family Christmas service on campus at Calvary. It will be a family-friendly service with the Christmas photo booths, presentations for our kids' programs, a baby dedication, Christmas songs, and so much more. Let's celebrate the hope of the season together, because we want to make sure we can fit everyone into the auditorium. We are asking for as many people as possible to register for the service ahead of time. Please only register those that will be in the auditorium. You don't have to register your kids if they're going to be in the kids area. Two, we really care about helping people move forward in their relationship with God by helping them discover what their next right step might be. One of those next right steps and crucial moments in a Christian journey of faith is a public declaration of your faith in Christ through water baptism. We're having a water baptism service on December 12th. So if you feel like you want to take that next right step in your walk with God, connect with us through our website by clicking on the Next Steps tab. We are also opening up registration for our Christmas Eve service on December 23rd and the 24th. Please head to our website and register for those services as soon as possible, because they're going to fill up fast. And lastly, there are just three ways that you can give today. Guests, ignore this part. This is just for those who call Calvary home. You can give online at calvaryptbo.church. Just click the blue giving icon and follow the easy prompts. You can also e-transfer to donations at calvaryptbo.church, or you can drop it off at the main office throughout the week. Now let's grab our Bibles, notepads, and something to write down with as Pastor Kathleen brings us our teaching today. He shall be called Wonderful Counselor.
Tis the season, Calvary. I love Christmas. Not winter, not darkness coming earlier, definitely not the cold, not being outside in the snow, but the festive warmth of Christmas itself. I love decorating. I love giving gifts. I love hot chocolate and cookies and Christmas baking. Not so much baking it, but the eating of it I'm really good at. And the warmth of this season has begun to wrap itself around us and pop up all over the city. If you attend church on campus, it's right here all throughout our building. And so I just do want to take a second to say a huge thank you to my small but incredibly mighty team who made all of it happen. Today is the start of Advent in many Christian churches around the world that follow liturgical seasons in the Christian calendar. And we too start today a four-week series focusing on the hope and relevance for us today of God coming to us in the most vulnerable of ways through a human birth, a baby who would become a toddler and then an awkward adolescent, and then a man who lived and served and brought in a kingdom like nobody had ever seen, and who would ultimately give his life so that we could be reconciled to the Father. May we just never find ourselves looking at this story in any other way than complete awe and wonder. Our series title is He Shall Be Called. Our text is from Isaiah 9, 6 to 7, where a prophetic word of hope that is still about 700 years away from actually taking place is given by the Hebrew prophet Isaiah to the nation of Israel. Now, the whole book of Isaiah consists of these two repetitive themes, one of prophetic judgment, and then in contrast, Isaiah offers words of hope and comfort and counsel that is so central to the gospel message. Isaiah constantly contrasts the futile counsel of the Gentiles against the powerful counsel of Yahweh, which we're going to look at when we get to Christ coming as our wonderful counselor. Today, I'm just going to primarily set the stage for you by giving some context to Isaiah's prophecy. And hopefully that's going to give you a bit of a relevant framework in which to approach these future weeks that we're going to go into. And then maybe you can connect some really important dots together that you just haven't put together before. Both God's mission for the world, as well as Isaiah's own personal mission, is really cemented in chapters 1 to 12. And so we're going to kind of camp out there this morning. The first few chapters of the book map out for us what a mess the people of God are in, what a mess Israel has become. Their affluence has bred corruption all over the place. Increased wealth had actually brought a diminished view of God, and people began to become secure in their sins. As long as they were performing appropriate rituals, they figured, we're fine, and they stayed in their sin and their rebellion. But God cannot be and will not be manipulated. And covering up and glossing over adultery can and will only last so long. And so God does what he often did when his loved creation gets off track. He speaks to them and he tells them how to get back on track. And in this case, he does it through Isaiah. Isaiah's judgment and woeful prophecy in these early chapters to the nation, the nation's hollow and empty worship, it goes kind of like this. And if you have the time, read chapter 1. It is an intense correction. I'm going to take this kind of summary right from chapter 1. This is basically what it is. Your ritualistic worship and routines, your pious meetings, your hands lifted in prayer, but with no internal work of the Spirit, I hate it. It is false, and it's sinful, and it's corrupt. And you are going to see in the coming days, in a coming time, where living like this gets you. So go ahead, but I'm going to let you feel the repercussions of your choices. A war is coming, literally Assyria is coming, and you will not win it. Not super hopeful, but something incredible happens in Isaiah's life that is symbolic of what God will do for Israel and what he is going to do for the whole world. Let's read it together in chapter 6, verse 1 to 8. It was the year King Uzziah died that I saw the Lord. He was sitting on a lofty throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Attending him were mighty seraphim, each having 6 wings. With 2 wings they covered their faces, with 2 they covered their feet, and with 2 they flew. They were calling out to each other, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of heaven's armies. The whole earth is filled with his glory." Their voices, listen to this, shook the temple to its foundations, and the entire building was filled with smoke. And then I said, this is Isaiah, "It's all over. I am doomed, for I am a sinful man. I have filthy lips, and I live among a people with filthy lips. Yet I have seen the King, the Lord of heaven's armies." Then one of the seraphim flew to me, and with a burning coal he had taken from the altar with a pair of tongs, he touched my lips with it and said, "See, this coal has touched your lips. Now your guilt is removed and your sins are forgiven." And then I heard the Lord asking, "Whom should I send as a messenger to this people? Who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am. Send me." And then he said, "Yes, go and say this to this people." So King Uzziah dies, a monarch that everybody had become far too dependent on, turns out, including Isaiah. That dependency gets cut off. And when he dies, all of a sudden, Isaiah has an encounter with God in a vision. And a lot of commentators believe that this is actually Jesus who he was seeing. There is a confrontation, a confession, a cleansing, and a commissioning. Like a good Pentecostal preacher, I found you 4 C's. It should be 3 if I was following the rules, but that added 4th keeps me a little bit rebellious, which is just how I like it. So Isaiah has this purification process happen, and it starts with confrontation. Isaiah came face to face with the contrast of God's holiness to what his own life had become. It was so powerful and it was so overwhelming that he thought it was actually literally going to destroy him. This is a holy confrontation. There is no hiding anymore. In full vulnerability, the hidden parts of life are exposed. Now, did God do this to shame Isaiah, to hurt him? No. But that which is hidden must come to light if it's going to be dealt with once and for all. In that moment, there is always a choice. You're going to see the process through, or you're going to cover it back up again. And Isaiah chooses to see it all the way through. For the first time in the book of Isaiah, Isaiah speaks and turns a prophetic woe against himself. Isaiah, when confronted with true worship, that seraphim worshiping the Lord God Almighty, he recognized his own worship, like the rest of God's people, had grown hollow and empty. It had just become a ritual, not an inner transformation. What he was experiencing right now was an inner transformation. It wasn't just about everyone else in this moment. There was no, their sin is worse than my sin. It was about himself, his own true condition, illuminated by the holiness of God. And so here at this altar of God's presence, because of this posture of confession, the remedy of grace is applied through cleansing. A burning coal is taken from the altar of perfect holiness, and it touches his mouth, and instantly grace is at work in his life. Guilt is the first thing to go. It's taken away. A weight is lifted. Sin is covered, not covered up. And there's a big difference. God doesn't do that. We do. No, it is fully taken care of by God. You can't take care of your own sin. I can't take care of it. Pastor Paul can't take care of it. A counselor can't take care of it. Those are all helpful tools. Do not get me wrong. And yes, utilize them. But sin is only resolved in encounter with the holiness of God. God gifted tools in this world were not ever intended to replace him. They were intended to reveal him more clearly. Do you want to know what my favorite part of this whole scene is? It's in verse 8, directly after this purifying encounter, where specifically his mouth was touched. Again, details in the Word of God matter. Isaiah was to be God's mouthpiece to his people. It mattered that what came out of his mouth was pure and empowered. And so the voice of the Lord says, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Who will go for the Father, the Son, and the Spirit?" And Isaiah is in this moment where he responds with a renewed and empowered preparedness. "Here I am, send me." God then, in that commissioning, counsels him, that's our sneaky fifth C, to carry out his redemptive will for his people. Isaiah went from, "Woe is me, I am good for nothing," to "send me." That is the power of true repentance and God's supernatural grace. God's voice is heard with greater clarity. Your life becomes a lot lighter. And what's ahead does not feel as insurmountable when you move out of an encounter with the holiness of God, empowered and under the counsel of God. At times, will it feel like those hidden parts of you, if they are exposed, it will destroy you? Yeah, I think so. I think that's a natural feeling that Isaiah too had. There's a reason Adam and Eve in the garden covered up when they realized what they had done. But that was the will of the enemy that they covered up, not of their father who loved them. He asked, "Where are you guys? You're away from me and I want you with me." Making yourself vulnerable to others and even to God is at times uncomfortable, because there is the holiness of God and the kingdom of the world contrasting together. Some of what needs to be burnt out of your life has been gripping on tightly for years, maybe even decades. But to you who is afraid of what it means or what it might cost you to let that go, to finally bring what has been dark into light, let's look to Isaiah 40, 28 to 31. "Have you never heard? Have you never understood? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of all the earth. He never grows weak or weary. No one can measure the depths of his understanding. He gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. Even youths will become weak and tired, and young men will fall in exhaustion. But those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint." You cannot run with all of that weight. You are not unaffected by it, even if you want to believe that you are. The cost of leaving your sin where it is greater than the cost of dealing with it. I'll say it one more time, like a good Pentecostal preacher. The cost of leaving your sin where it is greater than the cost of dealing with it. You may not want to admit it, but that dead weight is choking the life out of your relationships. If it hasn't yet, it will. Out of your God-given purpose. And it will accomplish the only thing the enemy is good at. It will continue to steal, kill, and destroy the joy that God wants to give you. You were never intended to live covered up, hidden, and numb apart from your Creator. Did you know that in the book of Zephaniah, it literally says that God rejoices and dances over you? That is the kind of Father you have. And the longer you avoid Him, and you can be sitting here right now listening to this and still be avoiding Him, the longer you miss out on living loved like that. And so Isaiah's life is set on a purposed trajectory under the counsel of God. And now God explains to him how Israel, if they want to walk in light and God's freedom, that they are going to have to go through a similar process. In the start of chapter 6 to 11, right after God commissions Isaiah to speak on behalf of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, with a disclaimer that they're not going to listen for a really, really long time, Isaiah asks this. He says, "For how long, O Lord? How long will it be like this? How long do I keep speaking to them on your behalf just to have them continue to ignore you?" And God replies in chapter 6, verse 11 to 13. Let's read it. And the Lord says this, "Until their towns are empty, their houses are deserted, and the whole country is a wasteland, until the Lord has sent everyone away and the entire land of Israel lies deserted, if even a tenth, a remnant survive, it will be invaded again and burned. But as a terebinth or oak tree leaves a stump when it is cut down, so Israel's stump will be a holy seed." Basically, he's saying until everything they've been foolishly depending on is torn right down, until almost nothing is left, that's what it's going to take in order for all that's become dead to be cleared away, to find out where there is still life, to get to that faithful seed that is incredibly small but is alive and is all that I need to replant and rebuild. They as a nation need to go through a purifying process. Isaiah in our series text in chapter 9, he's going to prophesy the hope of redemption. He'll proclaim that following that extended period of darkness will dawn a light when God himself will come to dwell among them. Emmanuel, God with us. But before that, Israel is going to feel what it's like to have what they've depended on let them down. What they have built on all the wrong things will be burnt right down to rubble. And then, when hope is almost lost, when darkness begins to become too much, and they think that surely they will be destroyed, light will dawn when a teenage girl, who even though it would flip her life, her best laid plans upside down, will choose to trust the counsel and the will of her God and will deliver a baby boy who will save the whole world. Here we have our text, chapter 9, verse 6 to 7. "Unto us a son is given, and he shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." The prophecy is expanded on in Isaiah, and it can be found in chapter 11, 1 to 5. "Out of the stump of David's family will grow a shoot, yes, a new branch bearing fruit from the old root." Remember that root that was left behind? The Hebrew word used for root, sheresh, implies a root that remains alive and sends up a shoot or branch. And in this case, it's Jesus, Messianic King. "The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might, the Spirit of the knowledge and fear of the Lord. And he will delight in obeying the Lord. He will not judge by appearance nor make a decision based on hearsay. He will give justice to the poor and make decisions for the exploited. The earth will shake at the force of his word." Remember that holy confrontation. "And one breath from his mouth will destroy the wicked, cleansing. He will wear righteousness like a belt and truth like an undergarment." This is not just any ruler. This is not just any king. These titles given in our text, given to the Son, they matter. They express the remarkable nature and the saving character of his reign. The book frequently indicates that God was powerful enough to destroy his enemies in an instant. Yet again and again, when the prophet Isaiah comes to the heart and the means of deliverance, a childlike face peers out at us. God is strong enough to overcome his enemies by becoming vulnerable, transparent, and humble. Christ's coming is the ultimate expression of the truth that God is indeed with us, not for our destruction, but for our redemption. Why will Jesus not need to make decisions literally based on what he sees or hears? Because he has direct counsel, wisdom, and knowledge from his Father, which makes him and only him a wonderful counselor. Wonderful, Pele, means a miracle, marvelous thing beyond our comprehension. That baby that wraps humanity and divinity up together is a miraculous wonder. And this is how we know this prophecy could only be proclaiming the Messianic King. No other earthly monarch would ever be described by these titles. This was a divine king. Counselor, the Hebrew word for counsel, and then translated is to advise, deliberate, or resolve, to determine, to devise, to guide, or purpose. The Father, Son, and Spirit together made a plan to redeem that which has been broken. Together they will determine that it is done, and they will see it through to completion. The arrival of this wonderful counselor will literally cause a holy confrontation between the kingdom of the world and its governance and the kingdom of heaven that is unlike anything we had seen. He will cleanse the sins of the world by lifting the weight off of his entire creation and putting it onto himself out of 100% commitment to the counsel, the will of the Father. Let's just quickly take a look at John chapter 3, verse 16 to 20. For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, will not be destroyed, but have everlasting life. God sent his Son into the world not to judge the world, but to save the world through him. There is no judgment against anyone who believes in him. But anyone who does not believe in him has already been judged for not believing in God's one and only Son. And the judgment is based on this fact. God's light, this is that prophecy fulfilled, God's light came into the world, but people loved the darkness more than the light, for their actions were evil. All who do evil hate the light and refuse to go near it. Why? For fear their sins will be exposed. But those who do what is right come to the light so others can see that they are doing what God wants. We have been given a choice on what we're going to do with this light. We can either continue to walk in darkness, hiding in fear or being exposed, or through confession of our sins and acceptance of this gift of God's love and grace, we can walk in light. To those who choose truth and light, he commissions us to live as citizens of this new kingdom, just like he did, expanding it and inviting anyone who is still in darkness into it. And how do we do this? By the counsel of the Holy Spirit, which he left behind for us. Jesus calls the Holy Spirit another counselor, another of the same, not another of a different kind. John 14, verse 6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can come to the Father except through me. If you had really known me, you would know who my Father is. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. He's saying, look at me. Look at how I lived my life. The words I spoke, the people I showed love to, I literally revealed to you the Father. I revealed his wondrous, miraculous, hard to understand will to you. And not only that, when the Father sends the Advocate as my representative, that is the Holy Spirit, he will teach you everything. And he's going to remind you, because God knows we forget everything. I mean, he's going to remind you of everything I've told you. I am leaving you with a gift. And here's the gift he leaves with us: peace of mind and heart. And the peace that I give you is a gift that the world cannot give. This is a counselor unlike any other. Holy Spirit is the source of all right advice. The Spirit brings conviction through holy confrontation. The Spirit is needed for any real inner transformation to take place. The Holy Spirit counsels, teaching, guiding, and revealing the Father. Every single one of us is being led by the Spirit. But we have a choice on whether we will allow ourselves to be led or not. I'm going to close with this. Christ came to be your light and bring you life. And he didn't take it away when he left, but he left it here for us to see the way to him, the way to truth, the way to light. Are you led by the truth, the power, and the counsel of the Spirit? Or are you refusing his counsel? Let me ask you this. When was the last time you had a holy confrontation with God so that he can reveal to you the dark places of your life that he wants to light up and bring freedom to? What weight do you have today that you are underneath of that he can lift off of you? What has been choking the life and joy and peace out of your relationships with others and most importantly, with him? The band is going to play a song and I don't want you to sing along. I want you to just sit with Jesus for 3 minutes. And now you're at home, so you can sit for longer than three. Because like he only needs a holy seed to save the world, he only needs a holy moment where you will listen for him to speak to you. And I can't tell you what his specific counsel is for you today. Not really. Only he can do that. And so let's let him. And not only in this moment, but go on from here and give him some real focused time to speak to you, to counsel you. Following this time of reflection, I'd just love to speak a benediction over you as you go into this season of hope, where we reflect on our wonderful counselor, our mighty God, our everlasting Father, and our Prince of Peace.
My peace train.
sing your praise. Oh Lord, oh Lord, our God, oh praise, oh praise the name of the Lord our God, oh praise his name forevermore, for endless days we will sing.
So now may you go from here and may you see the process all the way through. May you choose a full life lived, loved by God, choosing to walk in the freedom and the counsel of the Father. And as you allow yourself these holy moments of confrontation, may shame and weight be lifted off of you so that you can be commissioned to bring the kingdom of heaven here to earth now. I ask these things in the name of the wonderful Counselor, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. Amen.
Thank you so much, Pastor Kathleen, for bringing us that teaching today. As always, we want to make sure that you don't just hear the word and miss out on living it out practically. We would love to help partner you in that. So again, you can head to calvarypdbo.church and click the Next Steps tab to see some practical ways that you can move forward in your relationship with God. And again, don't forget to register online for a church family Christmas service next Sunday on campus. I pray that you felt encouraged and lifted up by being with the church this morning. We'll see you again soon. Thank you.